opportunity for an equal fight with the world champion on a surface he excels at. What better way to get one over on his former team and teammate than to take a victory here? Ogier has a real fight on his hands. Also in the back of his mind, he must be worrying about what happened to Loeb. Every creak and whirl in that car must make him nervous. And he is slower than both of his rivals.
I don't know what happened exactly. It smelled a lot, fuel into the car. And I have not the power as usual because I can be faster than that. Sometimes I'm trying to push, but it's impossible. I lost time all the time, so I don't know what happened.
Now is the time for Petter Solberg to capitalize. The win has been such a long time coming for Petter. This could be his chance. But Petter also has to look behind him because Danny Sordo is pushing hard. Let's see if Sordo can make any inroads into Solberg's lead. And yes, he has. A Mini will top the overnight leaderboard for the first time.
For the Citroën team, you've led rallies, you've finished on the podium, but to lead for Mini, does that mean more?
Yeah, to be leading Citroën home was really nice.
And there is confirmation. Danny Sordo leads by just 1 second from Petter Solberg. And of the two drivers that should capitalise on Loeb's demise, Ogier is only 2.8 off that lead, but Mikko Hirvonen is over a minute and 20 behind.
I'm very happy. The car has been working very well. It hasn't been any crazy driving at all. Also a little bit time on the gravel now, but because of the punctures in Germany, I backed off on the gravel and I lost a lot of time. But I'm 1 second behind the lead or something like that. So for me, it's been an absolutely excellent day to be back on the top again. And with the improvement we have got with the car before the rally, and you can see how important the small details are when you're fighting in the top, so very pleased.
We thought to be close after Germany, but not that close, no? So all the Mini team, we are really happy, but still 2 days more for the rally, so we need to stay concentrated and to try to continue like that.
How much are you pushing out there to get this?
I'm pushing really, really hard. At the end of the long stage, I go out to the car and I tell my co-driver, for me it's not pushing anymore, I do all my best, no?
And over at Citroën, how serious is that problem with Ogier's car?
We're just analysing it, but for the moment we didn't find anything, and so we're not concerned about that. And for the rest, yeah, I mean, the thing is also, he's driving for a championship. You can see Mikko, and you have two guys in front of you who are pushing like hell just to win the event, because they have nothing to lose anymore. So I think he knows after Australia, that was such a big opportunity to do something well, and he threw it away. That's why he doesn't want to do that here again. I think it's a little bit everything together, and tomorrow a good sleep will help.
Today, though, has been a huge disappointment for the thousands of people here to see the local hero in action. The world champion, though, has remained in the service park well into the evening, just for his fans.
Sebastian, how much does it mean for you to see your fans here still supporting you in spite of your problems?
For sure, I'm a bit disappointed for them also, that they are all waiting here and I cannot drive, so it's a bit frustrating, but that's it.
And what does this mean for your championship?
It means that it will start at zero again next time.
As Loeb attends a party held in his honour by his fan club, it's a very different looking press conference at the end of the day. In less than 3 seconds between these drivers, all with very different agendas, day two is set to be a huge battle. Join us for that after the break. welcome back to Access All Areas. Away from the battle for the lead, it's been an eventful start to the Rallye de France Alsace for some. Former F1 champion Kimi Raikkonen had a narrow escape on stage one, only to retire in a road section when, whilst warming up his tyres, he ran into the back of Henning Solberg and ended up in a ditch. Flew straight home. Ken Block had been running as high as 10th overall before he came across a stranded Peter van Merkstein on his roof. The Dutchman and his co-driver were unhurt, but Block was held up for over 30 seconds. Mats Osberg had shown some impressive speed right from the start and was beating the factory Fords in fifth. But a puncture on the penultimate stage of the day saw him drop over a minute and a half and fall back to eighth. Fellow M Sport Stobart driver Matthew Wilson struggled to find a good feeling, and his problems were made worse when his Fiesta picked up power steering problems in the afternoon. So, problems for Matthew there. His mechanics will be stretched to change the power steering in this 30-minute service. Over the course of a rally, WRC drivers have to navigate thousands of corners, all in the hope of tasting some champagne at the end. The steering rack and power-assisted steering system make this all possible. Here to explain is one of the engineers responsible for driving Chris Meek round the bend.
The steering system is fairly fundamental to the car because it's the thing that's in the driver's hands, and it's where they put the commands in to get the response back from the car that they want. So this in front of me is a steering rack, as it would be assembled in the car. What we've got is the two links that go out to the suspension. Now in here is where the steering column actually connects into this rack, and inside this rack is a rack and pinion system. And what a rack and pinion system is it's a small pinion gear, so it's basically a gear with a load of teeth on it, and then a rack is a flat piece with some teeth on it. So by turning the pinion a small amount, you move the rack one way or the other, depending on which way it turns. What we then do is we then attach a hydraulic system to provide some assistance, because what happens is there's a huge amount of resistance in the tyre itself. So when the driver turns the wheel, if they try to turn the wheel with no power-assisted steering, it would be very, very heavy.
You can see how the steering wheel is connected to the steering rack through the rack and pinion system. The pinion at the end of the steering column has teeth which interlock with the steering rack, pushing it one way or the other to change the direction of the wheels. As Tina mentioned, a power-assisted steering system helps this along, as a hydraulic pump forces fluid into pistons on either side of the rack, driving it in one direction or the other and lightening the load for the driver. Thanks to this feat of engineering, the effort needed to turn the wheel is dramatically reduced.
Without a power-assisted steering system, it would take you about 20 newton metres of torque just to get the wheel turned against the resistance of the ground. And to give you some idea of what the power-assisted steering system does is it reduces that to between 3 and 5 newton metres, so between sort of 4 and 5 times the assistance is provided by the power steering system itself. Now, the 20 newton metre torque is equivalent to 2 kilos, so a large bag of sugar, on the end of a 1 metre stick, and it's you having to try and lift that. So you can see why it's very important that this is assisted.
So we now know how the rack and pinion and power steering system works, but what about how it all connects together, right up to the steering wheel and ultimately the driver's hands?
The steering rack that we saw on the bench earlier lives on the other side of this bulkhead, just under the engine. That makes it easy for us to change if we need to get to it quickly. The universal joint, which is this part down here, comes up through the bulkhead. The joint itself is this part here, which means that as we turn the steering wheel, that turns the steering rack. And then the main part of the column comes here, leads to the steering wheel, which is the part in the driver's hands. Now, there's a few things we do with the steering wheel in order to help the driver grip. It's got this felt covering, which gives something for the driver something to grip on. He also wears gloves with grips on them. That means he's got good grasp of the steering wheel. It's very, very important that steering wheel is in his hands at all times.
When things go wrong with the power steering system, it is a marathon struggle just to get the car to the end of the stage.
Finish.
Perhaps it runs in the family. Petter's older brother, Henning, has also had to deal with the difficulties that power steering failure can bring.
I can't continue.
Rough gravel events are certainly where the rack and power steering pumps are the most susceptible to damage. But as we've already seen with Matt Wilson, lightning can strike on tarmac too. It's something we all take for granted, but power steering in a World Rally car is one of the most important and vital cogs in the machine to success. Day two of the Rally de France Alsace. The world champion has retired and Danny Sordo leads a three-way fight for the win. All three split by just 2.8 seconds. So can Sordo take his first ever win and give the Mini glory in what is meant to be just a development year? While Danny is fighting for his first ever rally win, Ogier is fighting for championships. With Loeb retiring, Citroën's manufacturer's campaign needs all the points it can get. And for Ogier personally, a win here could see him draw to within 1 point of his teammate at the top of the driver's table. And then there's Petter Solberg. Whilst the other two are fighting for first in their career, the 2003 world champion is looking to return to his former glories. The fastest time on the opening stage of the day, he takes the lead. But unbelievably, immediately afterwards, Petter has picked up a puncture.
Puncture, yeah. 6Ks, I couldn't feel it at all, you know. Just went slower and slower, and then we went off the rim, and then we calculated the last five, six Ks. Okay, we tried to drive slow.
Cruel luck for Petter, but now is the time for Ogier to take advantage. After the disappointment of Loeb's retirement, he's giving the French supporters something else to cheer for as he retakes the lead. An electrical glitch in the Mini since Finland means Danny Sordo is unable to receive the split times in the car. He just has to drive on the limit everywhere. He takes back the lead on stage 12. Can Ogier fight back? 150. As always, the Frenchman is pushing to the max here at the end of the stage. Oh, he takes the lead, but just look at how much he wanted that stage time. Julien Ingrassia certainly wasn't expecting that unorthodox line. Really wide on the exit at the stage finish. He was really lucky not to hit that lamppost. Which will all be very interesting to this man. Sebastian Loeb can only watch as this drama unfolds. Here with his fan club, the world champion flies off to the next stage. Whilst his teammate fights for the lead, Chris Meek is having an impressive first Rally de France. He's currently lying in fourth place. Oh, but his luck has run out there. That is a big off for Meek, but luckily it's only his pride that's injured. Meek's retirement promotes both the Fords, which is good news for Hirvonen's championship campaign. Lavola is still almost a minute off the lead and is struggling to get the right feeling in his Fiesta. Mikko Hirvonen is unable to find the limit of the grip too. Look at him struggling with the car there. It's a difficult situation for him. He can't fight for any positions. He's too far back, but he has to maintain.